Good evening. My name is Buzz Eisenberg. I'm a professor here at Greenfield Community College. And on behalf of the Social Science Department and Greenfield Community College, welcome and thank you for coming. I know we're competing with the Red Sox, but these folks have it all over the Red Sox, I'm sure. In 1782, Thomas Jefferson said, "Self-government is not possible unless the citizens are educated sufficiently to enable them to exercise oversight." And he was right. That explains why this college, why this community college, cherishes the opportunity to not only educate the students here within these buildings, but to also help educate the electorate by co-sponsoring forums such as this. Likewise, the local media, and we are lucky to have our local media, the Recorder, the Daily Hampshire Gazette, WHMP, WHAI, the Valley Advocate, WRSI, they have consistently shown their commitment to a Jeffersonian educated electorate, as well as an educated citizenry, by partnering and fully engaging students here, political science students at GCC, in producing and offering debates and forums such as this one tonight. I am very grateful to each of those media outlets for giving students an opportunity that is rare to take part in something very meaningful to educate themselves and to educate all of us on matters of great importance and which will help us on November 8th. So on behalf of Greenfield Community College, welcome, and I'd like to turn it over to George Forcier of the Advocate. I mean, you're not of the Advocate, you're of the Recorder. Thank you.
Thanks, Buzz. Good evening, welcome to tonight's forum about one of the big questions on the November 8th ballot, whether to legalize marijuana. I'm George Forcier, editor of the Recorder, and one of the sponsors of tonight's forum. I spent a lot of time trying to decide whether I should greet you all by saying hi, but I've decided against it. It seems many of us for years have pondered the possibility of legalized pot. Now it could become a reality. What the state's voters decide on this binding referendum could have wide-ranging consequences, which I hope we'll discuss tonight. No doubt some of those consequences will be unintended. So it's an issue to approach with as much information and knowledge as possible. That's why the Recorder and our partners have brought us together with this panel tonight so we can explore some of the presumed pluses and minuses of legalized marijuana. The Recorder later this month will be running several stories where we try to explore the issues in more depth as well. And we're hoping we kind of take some cues from the panelists tonight and from you about what issues we should pursue and explore in more depth. But it's a serious subject. I don't mean to make light of it, because there can be a lot of consequences. So I want to thank you all for being here. I also want to thank GCC for hosting us. And I want to give a special tip of the hat to Buzz's students, political science students, who worked with us on this project. Some of them are here on our panel of inquisitors helping out. A reminder, tonight's proceedings are being cablecast on GCTV and will also be live streamed on recorder.com and at our sister paper's website, gazettenet.com as well. So now to get started, because you didn't come here to listen to me yak, let me turn things over to our moderator, Chris Collins, who's somewhere. Ah, Chris, okay. Chris is a longtime reporter who's worked both with the Recorder and local radio stations, and now is working for the Frontier Cable TV organization, and writes a column weekly for the Recorder on local politics. So he's well-versed and well-suited to do this for us tonight. So, Chris?
Thank you, George, and welcome to Greenfield Community College and to tonight's forum. This is a real opportunity, I think, not just for the people in this room, but the people watching and listening at home, to get a new perspective or a different perspective on what's a very important issue that we'll all be voting on in November. The format for this event is a town hall discussion. It's not an equal time debate. I'm not going to have the stopwatch out. I'm not timing the responses of our panelists. No one's running for anything here, okay? The goal is to cover as many angles and as many perspectives on this issue as possible. Questions are being provided by our media panel. This is actually going to be in two parts. The media panel has questions. Those will initially be addressed to the various panelists to my right. We'll introduce everybody in a second. Any panelists will be allowed to respond to a given question. They just have to indicate to me that they want to jump in with a raised hand. The goal here is to have a rational and measured discussion. So I would ask that people refrain from interrupting the person speaking if possible. But attempts to filibuster a given point will be truncated if necessary at my discretion. Media panelists may be asking follow-ups during the course of the discussion. We'll have that opportunity to do so. As moderator, I will also reserve the right to ask follow-ups and move the discussion in a different direction when necessary. The first hour will be devoted to panel discussion, after which we will throw it open to questions from the audience. Note I said questions from the audience. Comments are fine, but this is not a forum for speeches. This is intended to be a give-and-take discussion on this very important decision we all have to make in less than a month. To get us started, the students in Buzz Eisenberg's American Politics class have produced a short video covering the background behind question four and the issues related to say. Let's go to that video right now, which will be on the screen behind me.
Good evening. We are here tonight to discuss question four, a ballot measure on legalization of marijuana in Massachusetts. My GCC colleagues and I, in Buzz Eisenberg's political science class, have put together a brief refresher on the history of this initiative and marijuana in Massachusetts. First tonight, we'd like to introduce the legal history of marijuana in Massachusetts. Starting in 1911, Massachusetts was the first state to criminalize marijuana, with the exception of prescription use. Since then, numerous other changes have occurred in the regulation of marijuana in the state, including the abolition of medical usage in the early 1940s. Going forward in 2008, a citizen-led initiative reduced penalties for possession of under an ounce of marijuana from a criminal penalty to a civil fine. Similarly, in 2012, citizens petitioned the legislature to bring legalization of medical marijuana to a statewide ballot initiative. Massachusetts voters passed that measure with 63% of the state in support. The measure we are discussing tonight was the result of a citizen initiative originally introduced in 2015 to the legislature with approximately 70,000 signatures. The legislature did not act on the measure, so an additional 25,000 signatures were gathered, far surpassing the minimum 10,792 needed to revive the initiative. With almost 95,000 signatures, question four was then added to the November 2016 state ballot for voter consideration. Let's turn to the issue at hand. Question four would make the following significant changes in the state of Massachusetts. While it would be legal for individuals 21 and older to grow and possess marijuana, many guidelines would still apply, including regulations allowing towns and cities to limit and prohibit use. Along with city and town regulations, the Act establishes a commission to implement the initiative and regulate the new marijuana regime. Question four would also impose a 3.75% state tax in addition to the current 6.25% state sales tax, along with the possibility of an additional 2% tax, which can be imposed by individual towns and cities. However, question four would not affect the following. The Massachusetts state laws would not supersede federal laws and regulations. Laws governing the operation of a motor vehicle under the influence of marijuana would not be changed. Public use of marijuana would remain illegal. Business owners would still be permitted to require drug tests of employees. In addition to the summary you've received, the Secretary of the Commonwealth has distributed the full text of the initiative as part of the 2016 Information for Voters pamphlet and is available on the mass.gov website. We want to thank the media and expert panelists for being here tonight, as well as our moderator and our professor, Buzz Eisenberg. Finally, we want to thank you, our audience, for being a part of this process.
Very well done. And George mentioned this, but it's an extreme pleasure to have the students from Buzz's class involved. And they've been involved in every aspect of this project, so we thank them for their hard work. Now it's time to meet tonight's panelists. We'll start with our panel of experts. To my immediate right is Northwestern DA David Sullivan. To his right, Paul McNeil, who is what's your title again?
Substance Abuse Prevention Specialist.
Substance Abuse Prevention Specialist, who also happens to be the director of the Opioid Task Force of Franklin County and North Quabbin, though it's important to point out he's not representing that organization at this event tonight. Attorney Dick Evans is one of the former member of the National Board of Directors of the pro-marijuana group NORML. That's the National Organization for the Reform of Marijuana Laws. He's a longtime advocate of legalization of marijuana in Massachusetts. And Will Luzier is the campaign manager for the Yes on 4 effort, which is the statewide effort to try and get Question 4 passed. Now let's meet the media panel. To my immediate left is Nikolai Anzoni of Greenfield Community College. To his left, Stephanie Sliz, news reporter for WHMP Radio. To her left, Kristen Palpini, editor of the Valley Advocate, who also writes a cannabis column, O Cannabis, which I'll tell you, if you want to read up on this issue, that's a great column to read every week. To her left is Kate O'Neill from Greenfield Community College. And at the far end, last but certainly not least, Tom Relihan, health and education beat writer for the Greenfield Recorder. So we're going to start off with our first question, which will go to Stephanie Sliz. And who are you going to ask the question of, Steph?
Anyone who wants to take it.
How about we send this first one to our good friend, Mr. McNeil?
Okay.
All right.
Is marijuana truly a gateway drug into more addictive substances? Why or why not?
So no one can say definitively that it is an addictive drug, but we have data around people who use marijuana at a young age and who end up using more severe, more addictive substances later in life. One interesting point that I had, so the National Survey on Drug Use and Health, which is administered nationally, noted that of those who do not use marijuana, 0% use prescription drugs. Of those who use marijuana, 11% do use prescription drugs. And that was of 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th graders nationally. So you can't say it's a gateway, but there's definitely correlation. We don't know if there's causation. It's hard to pin down.
But I know Dick Evans doesn't buy that argument at all,
yeah.
Right?
The notion of gateway drugs is kind of a rhetorical gimmick. Certainly, if you say, is marijuana a gateway to illegal drugs, you could make the case that it is, because it's usually the first illegal drug that anyone tries. So the best way to close that gateway is to legalize it.
Go ahead.
Hello.
Will?
Yeah. I don't know if is it on?
Yeah, it's on. You're good.
Can you hear me now? Another way that marijuana is a gateway drug is that folks are sent to the criminal market where the folks who are selling them the marijuana also have other things to sell them, harder drugs like heroin and cocaine and pills. And so they're put at risk because they're sent to that criminal market. And there's much more of a incentive for folks to sell them harder drugs once they're there.
But isn't it true, though, that I mean, I hear what you're saying, But if you talk to certain physicians, like Ruth Poti, will tell you that the first drug that kids are coming in using now is heroin. So Dave Sullivan, your thoughts on the gateway issue.
So let's start with the fact of the teen developing brain. Alcohol and marijuana are the gateways to addiction. And so let me just be clear that throughout the United States, all the medical societies have opposed legalization. The Massachusetts Medical Society, the Academy of Pediatrics. So let me give you some statistics from the Massachusetts Medical Society, which is the scientific approach to this issue. And that's why I want everybody to have an open mind. If you believe that there is global warming, then I think I can speak to you about science. So here is the statistic from the Massachusetts Medical Society. About 9% who try marijuana become addicted. About 17%, one in six teenagers who try marijuana, that's the 12 to 18-year-old group, they become addicted. And 25 to 50% of the people who use marijuana daily will become addicted. Let me really be clear. In Woodstock, the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, natural marijuana, before it was genetically engineered, was anywhere from 1 to 2.5% THC level. Marijuana today is 8 to 16% for the leafy substance and up to 90% THC levels for concentrate. This is a dangerous drug. It's not the drug of the parents, grandparents, uncles, and aunts that might have tried it years gone by. The marijuana today is 400 to 4,000% stronger. And that's something that we should really look at when we want to legalize this drug, which is a gateway to addiction, and maybe the science isn't out there yet. One thing we know is that the studies have not been done about the potency, a high potency of this THC on the future of youth and teens. I'm for teen brain development, and I think marijuana is counter to a healthy, productive teenager and citizen.
We'll get to Will in a second, but I want to ask a follow-up, David. You know, right now, you can possess up to an ounce of marijuana without really any penalty. An ounce of marijuana is a significant amount of marijuana.
55 joints.
It's a lot of pot. So what's the difference between making it legal for recreational use? Why not go the extra step?
So decriminalization in 2008 resulted in there being no prosecutions, no arrests, no incarceration, whether it be for Latino, Black, or white, for those that possess an ounce or less. So that is about 55 joints. That's a pretty significant amount. There hasn't been any criminal justice negatives about decriminalization. There has been a negative because we have more operating under the influence of prescription drugs, marijuana, and opioids. They present a very serious issue. So why don't we want to take that third step? It's really clear. What our proponents want to do is put the normalization and good seal, housekeeping seal of approval on marijuana. It's another substance that's going to impact us for many, many decades to come and derail so many teenagers, Black, Latino, white, Asian American, you name it, it derails them from school. The kids that smoke once, twice, three times a day, six or seven times a week, they develop what we call cannabis use disorder.
Okay, hold on. Will, you can respond, then Kristen. Guys, Will, your response, so, then Kristen.
First of all, we had a press conference this morning at Roxbury District Court. We had several folks talk about a report that was released by the ACLU, and they talked about their personal experience with being arrested after decriminalization.
Was that Massachusetts?
It was in Massachusetts.
When? 2008?
No, it was in 2010, 2011, 2012.
So that's about four people in Massachusetts that got hassled.
No, I'm sorry. There were 635 arrests in 2014 for marijuana. Arrests.
There hasn't been one in Hampshire and Franklin County, Athol. I can speak to my jurisdiction. We don't arrest for marijuana possession if it's under an ounce, period.
What about Wendell?
Nobody gets prosecuted.
What about what happened in Wendell, though?
Yeah, let's talk a little bit about the police resources that have been used against people, helicopters flying over their property, people jumping onto their property and cutting down their plants.
Let him talk.
people suggesting to them that if they didn't ask for a warrant, they wouldn't be arrested. That sounds to me like a serious violation of someone's constitutional rights.
Okay, Kristen Palpini has a follow-up.
While we're talking about how marijuana affects people under 21, in Massachusetts, a lot of people under 21 are already using marijuana. In high school, 25% of the students say that they use marijuana currently. That's a lot. So my question is, why not make it legal and use some of that tax money to help these kids who are already smoking?
There are many reasons to make marijuana legal, Kristen, and that's one of them. It's not the preeminent one, though. It's time to get real about marijuana in Massachusetts, and that's what the voters will have the opportunity to do on November 8th. And what getting real about marijuana means is acknowledging that we're never going to eradicate it through law enforcement measures, no matter how many helicopters you fly over grandmother's backyards. It means doing right by our young people and not propagandizing them and hurling scare stories at them and trying to help young people grow up and learn the difference between use and abuse and learn how to avoid problems with marijuana and not trying naively to scare them into a lifetime of abstinence. That simply is not going to work. We have the other objectives of legalization. You know, we want to bridge the divide between the races. We want to bridge the divide between citizens and the police. We want to raise new revenue. That's one of the objectives. We want to create new jobs and new industries. And so those are all the reasons we should legalize marijuana in Massachusetts. And the new revenue is only one of them.
If I can comment on why, so young people can already access marijuana, why not legalize it? The thing we see from, it's an odd for-profit market when you try to drive revenue off of basically an addictive drug. And so what we've seen in Colorado is something that when you increase access, retail access, you automatically increase use. And so that's something that concerns us about.
That's not what happened to the teens in Colorado, though. The use has been
actually
flat.
I can clear that up, Kristen.
Well, okay.
Colorado's fascinating around their youth use data, the 30-day use data. So Colorado as a whole is a pretty conservative state. Their numbers pretty much stayed level. But if you look at the two cities that had the majority, the vast majority of the dispensaries, it's Boulder and Denver, pretty progressive cities. So if you just look at 30-day use rates for teenagers in Boulder and Denver, it is 70% higher in Denver for 12th graders. It is almost 70% higher for 11th graders in Boulder, if you just take like a sample size. So that's something that you can't really look at Colorado and say, how has it affected young people in general? Because it's a mostly conservative, mostly non-substance using state. There are some pockets where, and mind you, in Boulder and Denver, there's more dispensaries than McDonald's, Starbucks, and pharmacies combined. So when you increase access, you inevitably increase use.
Anybody, one more thought on this before we move to the next question? David?
You're creating more access and more availability. And with youth, Colorado is number one in the country in teen use. Number one. So it's bad to begin with, and you only make it worse. And to address the adult situation, we don't have a breathalyzer for determining operating under the influence of marijuana. And the carnage on the road from alcohol and marijuana is severe, but at least we have a way to address alcohol through a breathalyzer. So what I would say about the access is that it goes up substantially with medical marijuana, and then the next and last step is the highest rates of use in the country right now, Washington and Colorado, are when they legalized it. And that's who we're really trying to protect. And one last thought. When you look at the graph of marijuana use in our country, and it starts at usually 12.8 years is the mean average for somebody trying marijuana for the first time. So I want everybody to think about your fifth, sixth, and seventh graders using marijuana for the first time. What happens is that that use, 12 to 20, is half the profits, half the money, half of big marijuana in this country. You're gonna create a $1.2 billion marijuana market in Massachusetts, and guess what? $600 to $700 million is on the backs of teens. And that's why when somebody says, we'll talk about adults, I'm talking about teens, half the profits. This is a for-profit business that's gonna be built on the back of teenagers.
Dick, I'm gonna let you respond, but understand that you still got...
Absolutely, absolutely.
Hold on, whoa. You're gonna talk, but you're not gonna talk right now. Dick Evans, your response. You're going to get a turn. Dick Evans.
Chris, there is no carnage on the highways in Colorado or in any of the other states. The sky has simply not fallen in Colorado or any of the legal states. The most recent study on youth use of marijuana comes from a NIDA-funded study out of Washington University, which traces a decline in youth use of marijuana over the last 10 years or so.
Nationally.
That is national,
but it's,
yes.
It's important to look at Colorado.
And you know, for every study that you mentioned, Paul, I can see you and raise you one.
If you can, please do.
But this issue is not going to be settled by molecules. It's not about scientific studies. It's whether at the end of the day is only a month away, whether the voters of Massachusetts will think it's finally time to get real about marijuana in this state. For the many reasons I've mentioned, I want to mention something about big marijuana because David mentioned it. Look, there's nothing, we've had big marijuana for a long time, except we didn't call it that. We call them cartels, and we call them networks, and we call them rings. But the difference about this, the big marijuana we're familiar with is they don't ask for IDs. And they don't pay their share of taxes, and they sure as heck don't resolve their disputes in courts with lawyers and insurance companies. So the question is, do we want an industry that is regulated and taxed and subject to reasonable control by municipalities and the state, or do we just want to cling to prohibition? And so I ask you, remember, folks, the choice is binary. The choice is between legalization and prohibition. So if you don't like legalization, and that's fine, but you have a duty to explain how prohibition is any better. How is prohibition going to keep marijuana out of the hands of young people? How is prohibition going to keep our highways safe? How is prohibition going to accomplish all these things that it hasn't already? Remember, at the end of the day, we really all want the same thing. We want to protect young people. We want to eradicate the black market. We want to curb abuse. We want to heal the racial divides. Prohibition has not accomplished those things. There is no prospect that prohibition will accomplish those things. Hence the necessity of turning to a system of regulation and taxation.
Will, and then Paul, and then Tom Relihan.
So, Kristen, you're absolutely right. High school seniors over the last 20 years have said that 80% of them have said that it's easy or fairly easy to get marijuana. Most say it's much easier to get than alcohol. And as Dick points out, that's because no one asked them for their ID. And look, we're just as interested as our opponents in making sure that young people don't use marijuana. That's why it's set at age 21. That's why we have a mandate in the initiative that says you can't have advertising that appeals to people under the age of 21. That's why we have childproof packaging and the whole nine yards. So, and the gentleman in the back is absolutely right. Mothers have said to us, look, I would rather have my 18-year-old son ask his sister, who's 21, to buy him marijuana in a regulated market where he knows what he's getting than to go to the current black market.
Paul, and then Tom.
I'm kind of glad that this is, it seems to get emotional, and it's a really charged subject. I myself am the benefit of medical marijuana. My dad last year passed away from melanoma, and on his way to treatments, my brother, who visited from California, I have no idea how he got the marijuana from California to Massachusetts, but he brought medical grade cannabis to my dad. He would use marijuana just before he got in the car, before he drove to Worcester, which was a half hour away. My dad had never smoked weed. It was really sad to watch him try to learn how to smoke weed, but it took the edge off of the transportation. It didn't cure his cancer, it didn't take away the pain, but it added to his comfort during his transportation. So I know some reasons why I'm hopeful, and I think I actually want legalization. I don't want this legislation to be driven by an industry, which is what the industry has written this law. It wasn't written by people in Massachusetts. It wasn't written by people for people in Massachusetts. It's written for an industry, and I'll tell you how. So it sets no limits on potency. And when you say it's childproof packaging and that's protective, something that's easy to forget is that you are still allowing sugar-based edibles like cola, gummy bears, brownies, cookies. I don't quite understand why sugar-based edibles are part of this law. If it is for adults, it just seems a little bit too child-centric to me. And when you mentioned, Dick, that there was no effect, there was no carnage on the highways, from the Rocky Mountain High Intensity Drug Trafficking Area report from 2016, the data reported marijuana-related traffic deaths increased 48% in the three-year average since Colorado legalized recreational marijuana prior to legalization. And during the same time, all traffic deaths only increased 11%. Okay. Just one more fact about driving impaired. Marijuana-related traffic deaths increased 62% from 71 to 115 persons after recreational marijuana was legalized. And in 2009, Colorado marijuana-related traffic deaths involving operators testing positive for THC and cannabis represented 10% of all traffic fatalities. By 2015, that number did double to 21%. So actually, there's like specific carnage in Colorado since the law has changed.
Thank you, Paul. Tom Relihan, you want to follow up?
Yeah. Am I on? Okay, yep. Great. So back on accessibility and what we're talking about here with driving, drug driving and whatnot. Sorry.
Talk a little louder.
He's shy.
So on the question of accessibility and drug driving, OUI and whatnot, though they're currently regulated and legal in some form, both alcohol and opioid painkillers are arguably more dangerous than marijuana alone. Alcohol was linked to the deaths of 88,000 Americans in the last year, and 40% of violent crimes, it was a factor. So marijuana, in contrast, is noted to increase the risk of accidental behavior-related death. But the DEA says that there has never been a single recorded marijuana overdose death. How can marijuana's continued illegality be justified in light of those numbers?
David, you want to take that first shot at that, and then Dick?
Well, the best place to look is Washington and Colorado. And what Paul mentioned was the Rocky Mountain HIDA, which is High Intensity Drug Traffic Area. I have the 167-page report, so if anybody wants to read it, the media or anybody, they can look at this impact on deaths on the highway. It went up 48% from when it went to medical marijuana, and it went up another 41% when it got legalized. That's 83 human beings, sons, daughters, nieces, nephews, that died on the highway because somebody had this THC in their system. And we don't know how high it was, but we do know that it was there.
I don't mean to be flip, but I'm just wondering when they started looking at that data, when they started recording that data.
Well, it goes back to 2006 when they kept that data. So it goes way back. And, you know, so that's some of the statistics. The other is, if people aren't aware, the Department of Public Health keeps track of treatment at hospitals, hospital admissions. Okay, that's serious. And for the 12 to 18-year-old teen group, 55% of admissions are for marijuana, for cannabis use disorder. That's well over 1,500 teens per year, at least in 2013 when they last reported, and this is a few years that have been expired, that are in for cannabis use disorder. I would say that would be in the millions of dollars to treat and help those teens in recovery. And guess what everyone had in common? Everyone in common is that they had problems in school. They dropped out of school. They went sideways in their educational efforts. And I don't want to see that happen to kids. And I do want to go back that when you look at the graphs, whether it's the Rocky Mountain HIDA or SAMHSA or anything, that 50% of the use of cannabis in this country is 20 and below. So let's just keep that in mind. That's why I'm such a strong advocate against legalization, making it more accessible, making it more acceptable to these youth that are out there that need to be protected by us, the adults, the voters.
Dick Evans, response?
How does prohibition protect young people? How does prohibition keep it beyond their reach? Isn't it available to most young people generally right now, David? How many more people will have to have their lives wrecked? How many more helicopters are you going to have to fly before young people don't have more access to marijuana? You know, how many people are going to have to be evicted from their apartments or fired from their jobs or denied their scholarships or kicked out of school or punished one way or another before, you know, in order to prevent the young people from gaining access?
I don't think legalization
prohibition is not going to achieve these objectives. The issue for voters is whether we can achieve these objectives better through prohibition or legalization. I think the answer
is Dick, you're making it more accessible. You're making it the norm. And you're really saying, as a society, that we accept that marijuana is okay for kids. We really do. What you're really saying is, just because kids are smoking now, let's make it even more accessible. Let's make it more accessible for teens and youth. You know, really, addiction starts at an early age, and the sooner that these big companies can attract youth to smoke marijuana or to eat marijuana, 55% of edibles in Colorado, 55% of the cannabis products in Colorado right now are edibles. That's chocolate milk, soda, gummy bears, chocolate bars. 55%. And you know who did that to us? The big tobacco. And big marijuana is doing the same. They want your kids, and they want them bad. Because they know if they can't get big marijuana, the million dollar businesses that want to come into this state really want your kids to smoke marijuana and to eat marijuana.
You know,
I'm going to tell you right now, before we go any further, this is on live TV and live radio. If you swear, you're not going to get near a microphone.
Yeah, that's a great way to protect the kids.
You're not going
to
get near a microphone.
Swear right now. Actually, Will. I have something to say about...
Paul, then Will.
Yeah. I have something to say about the tax revenue idea. So legal marijuana, it's been raised as an idea of driving a lot more revenue than we currently have in Massachusetts. Society gains about 15 to 20 billion bucks a year from the taxes imposed on alcohol. So while it loses over $200 billion a year in healthcare, criminal justice, and other costs directly related to alcohol use and abuse, it's a net loss. That's a ratio of 10 to 1 or higher, cost to ratio, cost benefit analysis. And tobacco is even worse. The $25 billion collected in tobacco taxes, it doesn't even come close to offsetting more than $200 billion in lost social costs from tobacco use.
So you would support prohibition of alcohol and tobacco?
The interesting thing about prohibition in Massachusetts is that it's sort of already de facto legalized. So you can walk around and you can share marijuana amongst friends as an adult, and there's no criminal penalty to do that.
If you're white.
Will.
If you're white.
No, there's has nothing to do with race in Massachusetts. In Massachusetts, no one's been arrested. At least in our neck of the woods, the Pioneer Valley, in the last 3 or 4 years, no one's been arrested for possession of small amounts of marijuana. It doesn't matter if you're white or black or Hispanic.
But you can't deny that there is a racial component to some of these
arrests.
Absolutely.
Nationally,
not,
absolutely.
Not I think Massachusetts, and that's what this vote's about. Not Massachusetts.
Not Massachusetts?
No. Period. Well, it doesn't. They know what the stats are. Over the last 5 or 6 years, it's been rare.
There's no
private
prison industrial complex. Okay. All right. Will, David, quick response, then Will.
All right. First of all, let me give you my take on racial.
I think it's the floor is mine.
Will, then David. Will.
Andrew Friedman said last week that
There hadn't been an increase in any demographic in Colorado, an increase in use in any demographic in Colorado, except for people over the age of 65. That's number one. Number two.
Who is that?
Andrew Friedman is the director of the Colorado Marijuana Program under the governor's office. Both of these folks to my left, not Dick, have talked about gummy bears. There is currently a regulation in the DPH regulations for medical marijuana that says you can't sell or manufacture anything that has any reasonable resemblance to a commercially available candy. Colorado has banned all of those kinds of things just going into effect in October. And we will learn from the issues that have been faced in Colorado with regard to edibles. There won't be anything that's and in any way resembles a commercially available candy. And there will be regulations there will be regulations that make sure that every portion of edible is clearly marked as a marijuana product.
David and Kate.
The edibles are attractive nuisance. Like I said, 55% in Colorado. The ballot initiative, let's get back to the ballot initiative. It doesn't prohibit edibles.
And it doesn't
therefore, it allows it. It doesn't set a limit on THC. If they really wanted it for recreational purposes, why wouldn't they limit it to maybe three times what Woodstock was, 7.5%? But they didn't. They opened up a canister of worms.
Okay.
They have opened up marijuana concentrates, which are known as hashish. This is the legalization of hashish, I hope you all know. The definition of marijuana is 2.5%
or less. I don't think anybody's going to complain about that in this audience.
It is the legalization of hashish because it doesn't set a limit. You can have up to 90% THC in a product, and let me tell you, that's where psychosis steps in, that's where severe, yeah, it does.
Okay, Kate, you got a follow-up? Kate O'Neill from GCC.
Even with medical marijuana as is right now, like you're saying, you have a client that has it. I know it resembles candy, but it all has prescription and is clearly marked as this is marijuana. This is not a product for a child. It has warnings. It has everything that can be done that says it hasn't been FDA approved, but has all of the facts on it to THC content, et cetera.
The regulations clearly authorize and instruct the commission, which is supervising the legal regime, to impose proper controls and restraints on packaging and labeling. And to say you're worried about an invasion of gummy bears is to say you have no confidence whatsoever in the regulators to write rules preventing them. And clearly that's a no-brainer.
Anybody else getting hungry up here? Steph.
If we're talking about health, shouldn't we be encouraging people to take cannabis via edible as opposed to smoking it and putting it in their lungs anyway?
I would love...
David? Go ahead, Paul.
I think that would be incredible. Smoked marijuana is not the best way to consume it. But it really is the lack of a set on the potency that's just really concerning. There's no reason not to set it at 15 or 20%, but that was specifically not done. And I think primarily, so again, this is an industry law. This is not a law written by us, proposed to our legislators. This is an industry law that was written by an industry looking to make profit. 50% of the revenue in Colorado does come from sugar-based edibles.
But it can't be changed, and it takes effect a month after it's approved if we pass it. Go ahead, Will.
First of all, you know, he says by the industry, not by Massachusetts residents. Dick was on the drafting committee. I was on the drafting committee. Mike Cutler was on the drafting committee. I think there were perhaps 20 to 24 people on the drafting committee.
And maybe. There were representatives of law enforcement. There were representatives of public health. There were representatives of educators. There were some industry people. I didn't see anybody from big marijuana at the table there.
That's right. And it's also important to remember that there was a recent study by the Brookings Institute authored by a guy named John Hudak. And the title of the study was, "Don't worry about big marijuana, worry about bad marijuana." And the reason for the study was he was saying legalization is happening in such a patchwork way across the United States that there never will be anything like big tobacco or big alcohol. That's just a shibboleth. And furthermore, what's important is to make sure that the product that's being sold is tested, regulated. It doesn't have, there was a guy who was arrested in Brockton a couple of weeks ago that had marijuana spiked with fentanyl, which is a deadly opiate. In the regulated market, the products will be tested. There won't be any pesticides. There won't be any heavy metals. There will be labeling, which shows exactly what's all of the ingredients that are on the marijuana. So you'll know what you're getting. And furthermore, you can buy 3-2 beer, or you can buy 151 proof alcohol. There's no reason the marijuana users can self-titrate, and the edible products will be clearly labeled with how much THC is in them, so everyone will know exactly what they're getting.
Nikolai Anzoni has a question.
First off, I would like to remind everybody that we've been here before with alcohol. That prohibition was deemed a failure and deemed that it infringed upon our rights. And so instead we chose a reasonable regulation. And now, much like then, people feel that our government is playing too big a role in our individual lives. So why isn't action taking in our own homes being prohibited by the state?
David?
So let's start with the title of this. Regulating marijuana like alcohol. They don't want to regulate like alcohol because they've eliminated home rule. Every municipality in Massachusetts will have marijuana unless they pass a ballot initiative in their own town to prohibit it. With alcohol, going back 100 plus years, it was always up to the municipality to decide whether they wanted alcohol or not. They have omitted that from this legislation. And in fact, they've given a free ride to the medical marijuana industry. They automatically get to sell recreational marijuana.
That's not true.
They do. It's right in the legislation.
That's not true.
That you automatically get a free ride. Oh, it's a little bit of regulations maybe, but you get first dibs. So everybody who got in early to the game of selling marijuana, of which about 90% is not for debilitating illnesses, for which it should be, okay? Well, sure, that's fine, 10%.
The average user in Massachusetts who applied for a license for marijuana was a 48-year-old white male complaining of lower back pain. And lower back pain wasn't in the law that I voted for. It, I don't know if you guys remember, it said cancer, HIV, multiple sclerosis, I think, chronic pain and other diseases.
Yeah, but this question gets rid of all that.
Yeah,
which just basically throws open the door.
So if we want Yankee democracy, then why did this ballot initiative get rid of our home rule?
Let me answer that question,
351
David.
Municipalities are now told, imposed, that you're going to have marijuana unless you form an initiative in your own community
to
prohibit
it. Oh my, let's let people vote.
Down
38%
in Colorado. Okay. Whoa. Okay, so we're all worried about heroin killing our kids, which we all are. You're flying around in helicopters harassing 70-year-old people with cancer.
I've never flown in a helicopter. Okay.
Get the mic. Hold on.
Was taken from the opioid money that was supposed to go for treatment. And you know what you did with it? You bought baseball cards for the police department in Greenfield to clean up their image. Isn't that a great use of our money that should be going to right. people with heroin addiction and opioid problems? $5,000 for baseball.
I'm going to make an executive decision. I think we're going to start taking comments from the audience now. Because that seems to be where the story is. Buzz Eisenberg has the mic.
I have the mic. I'm going to hold on to the mic. I'm going to recognize people.
Buzz, before you start.
Yes.
I will reiterate, we are on live radio and TV. Do not go there. Let's start with this gentleman right in the middle and finish your statement. This time on a microphone.
Okay, because we keep bringing these facts, children, children, children. I'm watching the Today Show. Mount Lauer came right out. Teen use has dropped 10%. So you give all these facts, all these old facts, the most current facts are from the state of Colorado, 10% decline in teen use of marijuana. The older folks like me with one arm in critical pain, chronic pain, yes, it's up 455%. Because you know why, Dave? We can now. And we're gonna vote for this and legalize it. But don't tell these folks that their kids are gonna have problems with it, because that's not a fact. The fact is, opioid deaths are doubled since this task force took over in 2012. Just look at the full page ad run by the Brattleboro Retreat. Okay. Brattleboro Retreat doubled opioid deaths, okay, doubled. Well, yeah. This is what they opened the door.
No, okay, David, let's respond to the five questions you asked him.
Yeah, you know, it seems like a lot of, first of all, I am a disabled vet and I smoke pot and it helps me instead of taking benzodiazepines for PTSD. So number one, there is a good use right there. And you guys use a lot of scare tactics. Right here, you try to put the opioid program along with the marijuana. It makes no sense. It says right here, allows people to home grow unless the neighbors don't like it. What if my neighbor's making beer? I don't drink alcohol. I don't want that. So, you know, to put scare tactics. The government needs to get the hell out of my house.
Buzz, hold that mic. I want to give David a chance to respond. He was basically hit with five or six questions, and then we'll go back to the audience. Go, David. Exactly. And I told you at the beginning, we're asking questions. David, go ahead.
All right. So my intent isn't to scare anybody. That's not impactful on voters. It's not impactful on youth. What I came with was statistics that are from the American Medical Society, the Massachusetts Medical Society, Colorado. And with respect to your use of medical marijuana, I agreed that medical marijuana should be allowed in Massachusetts for debilitating illnesses. I was also in favor of decriminalization. This is a third step that's way too far. And I respect your use. I didn't fly in helicopters. I never authorized baseball cards or anything like that. So I just want to say that for everybody here, I would just like everybody to listen to each other. Because my job here tonight is basically to give my opinion. You have your opinion. But what I want to do is answer your question with the person directly sitting next to you who's a physician. And I think Dr. Clapp might be the best one to be able to ask a question or to answer some questions about medical use. He served at University of Mass for over 30 years. He's a physician in the area, and I think he'd be a wonderful perspective on tonight to hear from a physician and what he's seen, heard, and what his perspective is on cannabis use.
Will.
The study that you talk about, that Matt Lauer talked about, there was a statistic. They said 27% of the people who were polled knew someone who had reduced their prescription drug use or their alcohol use by using marijuana. And it's also important to remember that in 2008, when we decriminalized marijuana, all of the district attorneys were against it. All of the sheriffs were against it. The mayor of Boston was against it. The governor was against it. And that passed by over 60%. In 2012, when medical marijuana was passed, the DAs were against it. The governor was against it. And one of the reasons that they were saying, it's because of the kids. And that's the same thing that they're saying now.
And look who's against this. It's big pharma, big alcohol, who's supporting the opposition campaign. It's big public sector, big law enforcement. That's who's supporting this thing.
Paul. This is who's against it. Massachusetts Medical Society, Massachusetts Chapter American Academy of Pediatrics, Massachusetts Chapter American College of Physicians, Massachusetts Academy of Family Physicians, Massachusetts Section American Congress of Obstetricians and Gynecologists, Psychiatric Society, Gastroenterology Association, Sociology of Neurosurgeons, Association of Practicing Urologists, Massachusetts Hospital Association, recently Massachusetts Public Health Association.
Buzz.
Yeah.
Hold it. Whoa.
Can I?
Hold on, we have a question. You're next. Okay.
You're
next,
a great point
David?
About Big Pharma.
Buzz, go ahead.
If this proposal becomes law, will it be applied retroactively so that people whose records have been stained can avoid putting a possession conviction on a job application?
That was a hotly contested topic in the drafting committee. But in Massachusetts, when you draft an initiative, it has to be very narrow, and you can't sort of change three or four or five different laws at the same time. So I think it will be up to the legislature to make a decision about allowing folks to get their records expunged or sealed once this passes. So we will hopefully come back to you voters if the legislature doesn't do that, so that we can make sure that those folks don't have stains on their record.
Paul, then Dick.
That's something that I think we all would like to see happen anyway. You know, legalization measure or no legalization measure, that's a social justice issue that every single one of us can get behind and absolutely rectify that wrong. But I don't think we need to legalize marijuana in order to someday do that. I think we can do that before we have a reasonable, responsible, public health informed piece of legislation that is in the best interest of everyone in Massachusetts, you know, and not just the people who are trying to profit off of it.
You're right, Paul. I agree with you. It would be nice if we could do that, but we can't. We have been going to the legislature for decades trying to get them to enact some sort of reasonable of marijuana reform, and they have blindsided us consistently. And that's why we're here tonight. You know why this is called an initiative? It's called initiative because the citizens, the voters, are taking the initiative to enact a law that the legislature has refused to.
Dick, we should also point out that the senators that went to Colorado and investigated this all came out against the question when they came back.
Yes.
So, I mean, you're right. They've had a chance to bite at this apple for a long time, but they haven't.
Remember, Chris, there are two issues before us tonight. One is legalization generally, and the other is question four. And if you support legalization generally, the concept of legalization, then you must support question
That's
four.
That's untrue.
Because
wait for a better law. This no, law is
you're not
going to
get
law.
A better law. They're
Paul,
not going to pass
we've been
it. They've
waiting
had, they've
for,
had multiple
Paul,
chances.
We've been waiting for 40 years.
I want folks to look up on stage and see two people who follow the money with these two individuals.
Okay.
Follow the money. Follow the money of Dave and I. We represent the public. We have no financial incentive.
Okay.
We have no financial incentive. Literally no financial incentive.
I promise this
no
gentleman over here, he was next.
And follow their money and find out what their incentive is for being pro
Go ahead.
Prop 4.
My name's Francesco Compagnoni. On September 13th, our home was raided with helicopters and the police. And after we were raided, the police told us whether this is passed in November or not, they will still raid you. And I will tell you why now. Earlier this year, the agency, the DEA, delivered its verdict. The decision is the DEA's response to a 2011 petition by two former state governors who had urged the federal agencies to reclassify marijuana as a drug with acceptable medical uses. Okay? Earlier this month, the agency delivered its verdict. Marijuana will remain a Schedule I substance, as reported by Newsweek. Now, the DEA didn't want to make the decision, so the DEA asked the Health and Human Services Department for scientific and medical evaluation. This is what the Human Service said. They concluded that marijuana has a high potential for abuse, has no accepted medical use in the United States, and lacks acceptable levels of safety for use, even under medical supervision. The letter said, the same company that said this, the HHS, owns a patent for medical use of marijuana. Okay? They got that use in 2003 and actually obtained a patent for marijuana as a neural protector, claiming it protects your brain against stroke and trauma. So the same people that says it's no good have a patent on it.
Good point.
DEA is owned by the drug companies. The DEA hired the state police in Massachusetts that are willing to terrorize people and are funded by them. Okay, so it's the pharmaceutical companies that are running this whole show. And it says, I saw on that thing, even if this law passes, the federal government can come in and play games with the state, and they'll still take your stuff.
Paul,
because it's
respond.
Against the federal government.
Right.
And I saw that was
and
the
that's
first
actually,
thing
yeah.
on your pay up there.
It's a good point. The question of the federal jurisdiction over the state jurisdiction is an important one. Paul, go ahead.
So since I get to present my opinion, I think the scheduling of marijuana is long overdue, right? So to have it scheduled as a more dangerous substance than cocaine makes no sense. I think we can all agree to that. Unfortunately, yeah, exactly. It's scheduled too. It's considered less addictive, less harmful, and has potentially more medical benefit than marijuana. So the scheduling, if I'm being, you know, honest in my opinion, it makes no sense. That's a federal thing. Fortunately, we live in Massachusetts where we have medical marijuana and access to medical marijuana, which is a great step and a move in the right direction. There's so much potential, and we're still not there with marijuana as medicine because we need more research.
Dick?
But I will say this. When you think about the legality of alcohol, and we're trying to sort of mimic the alcohol model, I want to remind folks that alcohol kills 100,000 people a year. Tobacco kills another 500,000 people every year. This is in America. These two drugs are legal, they are regulated very tightly, and they're the biggest contributors to healthcare costs in our country. So in a lot of respects, because of the prevalence, alcohol is far worse than any other currently illegal drugs, if you think about it, because of how accessible it is, and because America has a problem with binging on addictive substances.
Thank you, Paul. Steph, then we'll go back to...
I just wanted to say something that you said, Mr. McNeil, about looking at who's funding this. I also wanted to let people know that the no on question four, the Beer Distributors PAC has donated $25,000 opposing the legalization of alcohol, or of marijuana.
Yes, it's true, Stephanie, that the alcohol industry is supporting the opposition campaign in Massachusetts. But get this, in Arizona, where there's an initiative similar to ours, the company, the pharmaceutical company that makes fentanyl, you know, synthetic heroin, they donated $500,000 to the opposition campaign in Arizona. That's what's behind the opposition here.
Will, then back to the audience. Will.
And it wasn't only the beer distributors. There was $50,000 from the wine and spirits distributors. There was another $25,000 from a group of bar owners. Recently, there was $15,000 more from a group of bar owners, totaling $115,000 that our opponents have gotten from the liquor industry. And I want to respond to what I consider an ad hominem attack on follow the money. I am a retired public employee. I worked for 12 years at the Attorney General's office. I worked for 13 and a half years for two state senators. I worked for 6.5 years as the executive director of the Interagency Council on Substance Abuse and Prevention. And now I've taken my pension, and more than half of my income is from my pension. So please don't insult me by saying, well, I'm a public employee. Look who these people are taking money from.
So let me address, and you know, I'd never personally attack either Dick or Will, because I respect them as professionals.
This man's been waiting for a long time.
What I asked in the beginning, and Will and I had a televised debate, I asked that this campaign not take out-of-state money or special interest money, and they declined to take that offer. I said, let's take the money out of it, let's let the citizens decide, and they decided not to take that. They decided to take a lot of out-of-state money and to take special interest money, and look what happens. The truth doesn't always get out when you have money. Both sides, we want people to understand and learn. And this young woman here has had her hand up constantly.
Well,
if we could address her at some point.
I have a sense of what the order was in the beginning.
Okay. Yeah, Buzz has got the mic. Go ahead, Buzz.
So before we put the medical stuff aside, I would just like to say I'm a survivor of anxiety, depression, overeating disorder, undereating disorder, insomnia, and hypersomnia because of marijuana. And I would like to ask David a question here because he seems to know about the percentages a lot and the potency. But the audience, definitely I'm feeling a vibe that they may not know and they may be a little afraid of the whole idea. So I would like to ask the question, David, do you know the difference between sativa, also known as daytime weed, versus indica, which is also known as nighttime weed? Do you know the difference yourself?
I don't fully know the difference. I know this, but Paul does.
I didn't even know there were differences.
Paul knows. You know, yeah. I'm glad you brought that up, because if you look at what has the most medical potential in marijuana, and it's not THC, it's cannabidiol, which is non-psychoactive and non-addictive.
No.
And if you follow the percentage of CBD in cannabis within the last 4 years, it has stayed completely level. The thing that has increased exponentially is the THC. And I would argue that's because it's more profitable. And one thing I mean about follow the money is, you didn't hear mention an industry called tobacco, who is actually fronting the pro-marijuana movement. And I think that's very significant to look at, because tobacco is the number one killer of all addictive substances that we tightly regulate.
What are you talking about?
Winston-Salem?
Supporting the marijuana legalization?
Yeah, look at who's investing in vaporizers, look who's investing in tinctures, and how to administer marijuana in a more sort of discreet way, and it's absolutely big tobacco in the Winston-Salem, North Carolina area.
They're selling marijuana?
They're investing in the future of the marijuana economy.
Yes, they are selling nicotine. They're using new delivery devices instead of cigarettes. They're using e-cigs now, right? Vaporizers.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good thing, right?
Which you
aren't
can,
they much safer than cigarettes, aren't they?
We actually have no idea.
Why aren't you celebrating?
I represent public health on this stage,
that?
And we have no idea if vaporizers long-term are actually safer, because they still have nicotine in them. They also have...
Nicotine is not intrinsically dangerous. It's the tars, and it's all the particles and all the crap that you get in cigarettes that's dangerous. It hurts you. If you had a pure pharmaceutical supply of nicotine, it wouldn't be all that toxic.
I would be super duper in favor of vaporizers if there was significant data saying not only is it healthier, but it doesn't increase youth use. And what we've seen with tobacco dropping and plummeting in Massachusetts, which is a great thing, and public health has made amazing strides, and it's only taken 30 years of hard work, but we've seen vaporizers exponentially going up for young people because they're discreet.
And old people too, right?
I'm not really here to talk about the best interests of old people as much. I am here to protect young people and their public health.
I promise this guy's had a lot to say from the floor, so
I don't need that.
Yes, you do.
Yeah, you need a microphone.
Television can't.
You need a microphone to be heard.
He'll hold it.
Monty calls me Steve the Hippie. Dave, I've walked with you. I'm sorry if we're at odds. Okay, let's talk about the historical things of some of this. There was never any credible scientific or factual evidence in 1937 when they made it illegal. The DuPonts invented synthetic fibers. They did not want to compete with hemp. The Hearst bought the rights to all the old growth timberland in the Pacific Northwest for paper. They don't want to compete with hemp. And we have Harry J. Anslinger, who's out of a job because Prohibition ended. He needs a new crime to keep his humongous federal police force at work. So now we associate the smoking of marijuana with black folks, Mexican folks, and deviants of that time period as conventional society labeled them. There was never any credible evidence. The most credible study was the one Nixon had to appoint a panel under the Controlled Substance Act. He expected them to say what he wanted. They came out, and I quote, it's a 1,184-page report endorsed the removal of criminal penalties for possession of marijuana for personal use and casual distribution. Cannabis should be studied for possible medical benefits. The worst aspect was the legal penalties against the use of marijuana. That is their conclusion. It has constantly been used as a wedge issue, and I can go on forever. The counterculture, okay? That's how Nixon dealt with it. We'll create, quote, the war on drugs. It was a war on the non-corporate, non-white Anglo-Saxon Protestant cultures. That's what it's always been a war on.
Paul, respond.
Okay, no, I have a lot more to say about this.
No, you're done. Paul, go ahead.
Another thing I want to point out about following the money is when we think about this ballot measure, who stands to benefit from the outcome? So right now, if I'm an adult in Massachusetts, if I want weed, I can get weed and I won't be criminally charged there won't be any criminal offense. If I'm an adult and I want to share weed with my friends and socially use it recreationally, there's no criminal charge against that. It's not illegal. You can do it. It's de facto legalization. So who actually benefits from commercialized monetized, industrialized marijuana, and it's not people in Massachusetts. And the social justice issues that we're definitely needing to continue making progress on for minorities being disproportionately jailed or imprisoned for small amounts of marijuana, I want us to fast forward like 10, 15, 20 years. When we think about retail outlets for addictive drugs, when we look at urban centers in America and look at alcohol outlet densities, disproportionately, exponentially more dense in poor urban African-American neighborhoods. This is public health data.
Dick, then Nikolai.
That could happen with marijuana retail outlets is what I'm saying, because people want to sell their product where they're going to sell it the most. And the highest using people are going to make them the most money. And you have to get people to start using as early as possible, think tobacco and alcohol, to make the most possible money for the lifetime users.
It's a legitimate question, who is benefiting from legalization? And let me answer that question. It's taxpayers, it's minorities, it's parents, it's employers, it's employees. It's all of us who will benefit from legalization. Legalization is not for stoners.
And who's benefiting from prohibition now?
Young people.
Nikolai, and then we'll go back to the audience. Go ahead.
So feel free to correct me if I'm wrong, but if I'm remembering right, in, I believe it was Colorado, they made so much tax money that they had to write a check to the citizens refunding some of that tax money. Think about what this state could do with that much tax revenue. Where I am, I have bridges that have gone out that we can't fix from a hurricane like 3 years ago. With money from something like this, that much tax revenue, we could do a lot to fix our infrastructure.
3.75% that has been indicated to be the tax will be the lowest in the country, and it will not outweigh the social cost of marijuana. Let me ask you, what's the cost of one kid dropping out because he's smoking weed all the time? What's the cost of one per... All right. I can spend on
refreshment. All right. Colorado
collected $135 million in taxes in 2015. It cost them to administer the marijuana program $25 million. They had $110 left over. They're building schools, they're creating jobs, they're doing all kinds of stuff with that money. But it's important to remember that the revenue is not the only reason, it's not even the main reason why we're advocating for this. We're trying to get rid of the black market, we're trying to take it away from the criminals, we're trying to make sure that it's a safe product, and if you're interested in public health, you should be on our side, because the public health will be protected much more than it is now.
State Treasurer Deb Goldberg says that the tax proposed for recreational marijuana is too low compared to other states with legalized marijuana, saying, quote, the higher the better. There's a 6.25% sales tax, potential 2% local option tax on top of the 3.75%, while Washington, Colorado, Oregon, and Alaska have around a 30% excise tax as well as that. Legal cannabis supporters say tax rates should be kept low enough to suppress the black market. Is there an issue with the proposed taxing as the way it is?
Zero tax, 100% tax on a bad thing is still a bad thing. Okay? So it's bad for kids, it's bad for their health. And let's face it, if half the marijuana use in Massachusetts is on the backs of those that are 20 and below, we shouldn't encourage its promotion. And let's go back to the tax issue.
Hold on.
Nobody ever calculates the real social cost. I want you to think about the 1,500 kids who got hospitalized last year for cannabis use disorder. And what did that cost? What did that cost the hospitals? And you know what? It's interesting. I haven't interrupted a single person here. Well, no.
All right.
Let's be clear. We all have opinions. All right.
In the back.
It's really a decision that requires people to think about the health cost, the social cost, and where we want to see our society go. Where did we ever get off that we want to build a society on kids, youth, and adults getting high? Why do we have to escape reality? Why can't we have values where we encourage our kids to have good decision-making and life skills? There isn't a single nickel that's targeted toward prevention, intervention, and youth development in this bill. Not a single thing.
Let's
not a single dime.
Let's go to the audience.
I don't think that's true.
Buzz has a question in the back from someone. Go ahead, Buzz.
So I'd like to thank the panel and the journalists for participating tonight. And I guess my question, perhaps maybe to the only politician up there, David Sullivan, is if you think that decriminalization was a good thing, and I guess a recent Harvard study said that it was going to save about $30 million in prosecution, police costs. I don't know if that's true, but Harvard has a fairly good reputation. Why is it that every single person in law enforcement and every single politician opposed decriminalization, and yet it won in a popular vote in every single city and town in Massachusetts, except for two, I think, maybe three? And when we talk about money in wherever it comes from to pay for campaigns, wouldn't anyone, yourself included, Mr. Sullivan, be frustrated that the people have spoken about how they think their lives should be governed and what the law should be about, but have been stymied by state legislators and politicians up and down the line? So I just want to understand, why is it that you didn't support decriminalization, or maybe you said you did or changed your mind, flip-flopping, whatever it is? I'm just curious why politicians stand in the way.
Okay. So yeah, let me start with that. By the way, we're all politicians, okay? That's as simple as that.
I'm Paul McNeil.
Just because you're not elected doesn't mean, he's running a campaign. But anyhow, I'm proud of the fact I am a politician. Let me go back to decriminalization. I was a defense attorney for 16 years. And I certainly represented people for a number of different substances for which they are accused of possessing. I felt that decriminalizing marijuana outweighed having a criminal record. I knew what the impact was to getting a job or to getting an education, you know, student loans. In Massachusetts for over 40 years, we have not had a guilty finding for simple possession. It's a continuation without a finding and a dismissal. So just to be clear, most people didn't end up with a criminal conviction for marijuana. But I looked at that, and that was before I was DA. It was passed in 2008 before I was elected in 2010. So that kind of shows you that, you know, I was clear to everybody I knew that I thought that decriminalization was a good step forward to avoid that stigma of a criminal charge or a criminal conviction. So that's where I stood on that issue. And the medical marijuana, I was in favor of a good legislation. I wasn't in favor of the legislation that got passed because it was a big, wide open hole that didn't define debilitating illness. And now we see it really not properly implemented. There's a lot of folks that are using it for recreational use as opposed to debilitating illness. So I've been consistent with my belief in the fact that we can have a better society. We don't have anybody being arrested in my jurisdiction. In most jurisdictions, if there is an arrest, it's usually coupled with something else. So it's very uncommon in Massachusetts now. We have over 6.5 million citizens for anybody, any race, color, creed, age, to be arrested for simple marijuana possession. And I want to keep it that way. So I think we have a good equilibrium right now with medical marijuana and decriminalization. And the criminalization, really, I believe, and this is my belief, you know, by the way, when they talk about law enforcement, every district attorney is opposed to legalization. The Attorney General Maura Healey is opposed to criminalization, and so is the Mass Chiefs of Police Association. So there's a balance there. There's a difference of opinion. But I think, why are we in such a rush to legalize when we don't even know what the no? Okay. But why are we in such a rush?
All right.
See, I didn't interrupt you folks. But we've made big strides toward legalization. We have an experiment going here, and the big experiment in the United States right now is Washington and Colorado that have legalized, and that experiment isn't going so well.
Tom Rellahan has a point here. Go ahead, Tom.
The question of decriminalization, the question of decriminalization, doesn't that to some extent encourage people who use marijuana to purchase on illegal markets or require them to if they want to use it without a legal system to govern that?
Paul.
So something that you would hope is that the black market would have disappeared in Colorado. Something I imagine would happen here is something that was similar to Colorado, where you have a non-taxed medical marijuana, which is the exact same Bubba Kush, and it's the exact same Bubba Kush as recreational marijuana. Recreational Bubba Kush is more expensive because it's taxed. Something that happens in Colorado, because it's not a prescription drug and it's not monitored by the prescription drug monitoring program with the medical program, is that you have people who are 18 to 21 obtaining their medical marijuana. And this is why it's important to have strict medical understanding for when marijuana should be prescribed, because it's not prescribed, it's not a drug, it's not approved by the FDA. But if it were allowed for very specific things, which it's not, it's very broad, this is what it would have prevented. So you can go and you can get medical marijuana for whatever ailment the doctor gives you a license for. Then you can then go and to any other number of dispensaries, medical dispensaries, and basically obtain as much marijuana, completely untracked and unregulated, as you want in Colorado, and sell it for just a little bit less than the recreational market is there, and it turns into a gray market. I have no idea why that wouldn't happen here. And so it's not as simple as we need to get rid of the black market. We need to maintain the status quo. I think it's a lot more complicated.
Okay, now we've got a lot of people in the audience that want to speak, so I want to make sure that I get people's questions in. So let's go to the audience right now. We'll come back to you, David. Go ahead.
Hi. I just want to first say that I really sympathize with the concern for kids. I mean, it worries me too. I'm not sure where I stand on this, but I just want to say I have a question. Why is it then when we're at a time where students are buried in student loan debt that they're not going to be able to pay for the rest of their lives, why is it that probably 60% of our kids are obese? Why is it that we have genetically engineered food in our food system, and this is all eventually going to kill our kids, yet somehow the moment that people over 21 as responsible adults would like to have recreational use of marijuana come into play? Why is that all of a sudden, why do we all of a sudden have to make it about the kids? I mean, it seems to me like if it was about the kids, we'd be making more responsible choices about the food we give them, what's in our food supply, you know, affordable education, affordable health care, a chance at decent schools, schools that aren't crumbling. I mean, why is marijuana being picked on? It just doesn't make sense.
Well, David, you're the public policy guy here. You want to take a shot at that?
Nobody's picking on it. I'd like to talk about genetically modified marijuana. For 4,000 years, it was between 1 and 2.5% THC. Because we've allowed illegal drug dealers to modify it over the course of time, now we're up to 18, 20, 30% for marijuana. And because we can now distill it into concentrates, it's up to 90%. So I'm all for Elizabeth Warren and the fact that every student in America should be able to refinance their loans. Genetically modified food is not a good thing for most people. And just even putting gluten into all our foods isn't good. But I think with marijuana and sugar, so I think you make a good point. But the point that I've been trying to get across is that we now know about brain development that we didn't know before. We didn't know that the brain was still developing very strongly between 16 and 23 years old and up to 25. Now we know about brain development, just like we know about global warming. We have the facts. Scientific America wrote an incredible story about the developing brain. And if you read that article by Scientific American, you'll be convinced that marijuana is really not a good thing while people's brain is developing. And I'm talking up until the age of 23, 24, 25. Just so people know, marijuana use dips dramatically at 25. So the market for marijuana is between the ages of 12 and 25. And just like tobacco, and just like alcohol, you got to get people drinking and smoking at an early age so they can develop that addiction.
Dick, quick, and then we're going to go to the audience.
I've been advocating for marijuana law reform for about 4 decades. And every opportunity that I have to do it, there's usually someone that says, kids, 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 and then always raises the latest scientific study that shows that kids are going to, be destroyed. Now, it's always last week's study or last month's study or last year's study, but they never seem to hold up. Can Paul or David, can you cite any long-standing scientific studies that prove, that are well accepted by the scientific community, that establish the danger of marijuana? And when you answer that question, cite some studies that support prohibition, would you? You haven't cited any scientific studies that support the notion that are arresting people or firing them or punishing them or scorning them or whatever is better for them than allowing them to smoke a joint.
But I don't know that you have any specifics, but if you have them.
Oh, I've got them right here. I got 167 pages right here.
Please don't read them all.
And I'm not going to read them all, but I think anybody who goes to the National Institute for Health,
NIH.
Anybody who goes to the World Health Organization, which is around the world, has done a study, and it really talks about the debilitating effect of chronic marijuana use.
That's not the question, Dave. The question is, what's the scientific support for prohibition?
The scientific, it's something we decide as society, whether we want to accept it or reject it.
You're saying there is none?
I would argue.
What do you mean a scientific study?
Yes, you got 65 pages of science there, David. I'm asking you, where's the science that supports prohibition?
No, I've got the science that it's bad for brain development.
I would argue it's not.
That, to me, is an argument to keep it out of the hands of the legal, to make it legalization okay. It's...
Okay.
All right, this young lady's been waiting a very long time, Ms. Moderator.
Hi, my name is Nancy.
Thank you, Buzz.
Hello, my name is Nancy. I live in Turner's Falls. And I want to ask first, why is District Attorney David Sullivan the only one sitting there who's against the legalization of recreational marijuana?
I'm against it.
Okay, it sounds like you were for it.
We've got two and two.
Anyway, all right.
Oh, I would love to be for legalization if the law was right. This is not the law that we want
to legalize marijuana. Okay, I agree. This law is not right for us right now. And I would like to quote the National Institute on Drug Abuse, NIDA, stated in its section on marijuana on its website, NIDA for teens, assessed December 29th, 2006. THC, which is the Delta 9 tetrahydrocannabinol,
nice,
is up to no good in
David, explain to us why the responsible use of marijuana by adults with no visible harm to themselves or anybody else should even be the subject of criminal justice.
Can I jump in on it?
Why should it even merit your attention?
I'm going to jump in on this because...
Will, you're next, Dr. Paul.
Adults can already smoke weed now. You can already share marijuana with your friends. You're not going to get arrested. Yeah, well, so I'm interested in different laws that would look at, so this is my problem with this law. It's about industrialized marketed marijuana. It's about a market, it's about commercial, it's about revenue. And it's not about people and it's not about our kids. It doesn't care about our kids, it cares about making money. So I if you want marijuana in a legal market, if you want legalized marijuana, we already have a de facto legalization now.
Will, and then Kate.
Wait a minute.
Will, no.
Think about what this term commercialization means. Commercialization means this is going to be regulated. Commercialization means that consumers are going to be protected from pesticides or contaminants or impurities. Commercialization means that young people are going to be asked for IDs. Commercialization means that we will have strict controls and regulation instead of leaving it to the black market. Would you rather have the market controlled by criminals or by regulators?
Dick, your wingman wants to say something. Go ahead.
Thanks, Dick. I just want to go back to the issue of arrests. In 2015, there were 635 arrests for possession. I invite the district attorney and Mr. McNeil, excuse me, let me finish, please. Let me finish, please. To look at the ACLU study that came out this morning. It says that if you're Black or Latino in Massachusetts, you're still, after decriminalization, 3.3 times more likely to get arrested for possession than you are if you're white, and you're 7 times more likely to get arrested for distribution than you are if you are white. And that means that Black and Latino folks are getting arrested for selling marijuana to white folks who aren't getting arrested for using it.
Kate, and then back to the audience. Kate, go ahead.
Initially, my first question was going to be for a district attorney, Sullivan, and it was about how there's been recently a lot of discussion on mass incarceration, the fact that the U.S. leads in per capita inmate population, and what would question four have as an impact on incarceration rates and prison spending. But now I'm kind of leaning away from that and more towards, why are we encouraging a black market to still exist if it's decriminalized?
So the black market's gone up in Colorado. I hope you know that. The black market's gone up because now it's more acceptable, more accessible, and the dealers can sell it cheaper and undercut. So that's the report out of Colorado. Reason.
What about here, though?
It's the report out of Rocky Mountain, Haida. You can look it up yourself if you want to look at the facts and the evidence. So the reason why we work as a society, we work as prevention coalitions to prevent addiction. Addiction starts for two major reasons. The age of first use. And also, what we can't control, 50% is genetics. So right. that's why I really look at it as a huge cost to society. Everybody who gets addicted to a substance, whether it's tobacco, alcohol, or marijuana, and again, remember, Big Pharma said that OxyContin and Vicodin were not addictive and harmless. They were wrong. And marijuana does have an impact on people's futures. And I'm a big supporter of Black Lives Matter, and this is a class issue. Marijuana derails poor kids. Kids that are struggling in school that then take marijuana, they struggle even more. And there is a one cent that goes toward kids and their dropout rates and truancy and getting kids back in school and giving them a chance to regain the footing because they got addicted to marijuana. I wish this legislation took care of the 1,500 kids that got hospitalized and the thousands of kids that get treated.
You can't do it.
And the thousands of kids that get addicted to substances. And again, 55% of the treatment admissions in Massachusetts were for marijuana, cannabis use disorder in 2013.
We still have a half an hour to go here, so now, people that have your hands up, you're going to get to you. Let's go to the audience right now.
I just follow up really.
Okay, I'm really glad that DA Sullivan has talked about his love and care of children and all the poor people that have all the problems that you're so worried about. My question to you, DA Sullivan, I went through a horrific experience in my own yard. You sent them. The only person that they would, I want to just say, I'm sorry, I'm really upset because I had a helicopter circling over me for a good 5 to 10 minutes, so much so that my heart was pounding from the reverberation of the wings, okay? 120 feet at the most over the top of our garden. Then your men came. They were on our property for 45 minutes to 1 hour. Before any one of them would even give us their name, okay? We didn't know who we were dealing with. We just knew we had 5 men in our yard tearing our garden apart, okay? I feel like I participated in a total scam. I did everything that I was supposed to do according to the state of Massachusetts, the laws. I went to the doctors, and I'm not one of your little statistics that you've come up with saying that I don't really need it, okay? You want to look at my scars? You want to see where my kidney was taken out? No. Okay, all right.
So let me respond.
I have a real, real reason, okay? Right. And I'm going to tell, could I please finish what I'm saying? Okay, so these 5 guys, I'm a medical marijuana patient. I was told by my doctor that we could grow, I had 5 plants
of my own growing in the yard, okay? Your SWAT team came in, would not tell us their names after we asked them several times. The only thing they would say was, I work for D.A. Sullivan. That's who's my boss. You can call him and ask him who we are.
Okay?
All right.
So let me respond. Let him respond.
I want my question. My question to you is, the amount of money that you spent to come to my yard and take my plants out of the ground and terrorize us, okay? That had to be in the thousands of dollars. I know young people I know Franklin County has a waiting list a mile long to get into halfway houses. I know people with opioid addictions that are dying to have help and support, and they can't get it. They don't know what they're gonna do because they've gone through drug rehabs for opioid, heroin, whatever, and they can't get into a halfway house to help them get through the rest of their process. But yet, you're spending our taxpayer money coming after people who think they're cooperating with the law, waiting till the 11th hour. You have my name, you have the state of Massachusetts, and our Attorney General Healy, who won't respond to us, have all our information. They could contact us by phone, they can contact us by email, they have our bank records, they know everything about us because we had to apply for a medical hardship. So I want to know how you justify wasting thousands of taxpayer dollars to terrify a person like myself and an 81-year-old woman in Amherst who had one little plant in her raspberry bush. Well, how do you justify that and not use it to help you?
Okay.
Let's allow him to answer.
All right. Well, thank you, and I'm happy to respond. Number one, I'm sorry for your invasion of privacy.
Let me respond.
I'm sorry for your invasion of privacy, and I'm sorry that those resources were spent that way. But let me be clear. The people who conducted that helicopter surveillance and extraction of marijuana plants never have worked for me. I believe it was the DEA and the Massachusetts State Police. They don't work for me. I never spent a nickel. I never authorized that at all. And in fact, when I read it online, I was very surprised. They should use their resources much more wisely. The idea behind the medical marijuana, which I was in favor, okay? And I appreciate your use of marijuana for legitimate debilitating illness. And that's something that law is out to protect. And I believe that under the law, you know, I know there's a technicality. You have to supposedly cultivated indoors, but it's probably easier for some people outdoors. So I'm sorry for your troubles, but please don't accuse me of conducting that raid. You called them my men, and you said I authorized it. I did not.
Okay.
I didn't send them.
Question.
I didn't send them. Okay. Yeah, okay. But I didn't send them. It had nothing to do with it.
Yeah, Dick Evans, and then we're going to go back to the audience. Dick.
David, are you willing now in front of this group to totally condemn and repudiate that raid?
I think it was a poor use of resources for people that had three plants or less. I think
to ask for the discipline of those people who use your name, your good name?
Well, now that the issue's been raised, I will find out if people were using my name, and if they were, they had no permission to use it. So,
have you expressed your outrage to the state police and the DEA for what they did?
I think you just did.
If we can focus on the issue tonight, can I make a comment, Chris?
As a point of information, I'd like to say that the DEA spends about $1 million a year on this program, and the last information we have is 2014. That $1 million eradicated 111 grow operations outside. So that's what's happening with this program, and that's how the money's being used. And it does come from the federal government.
$1 million for 111 plants?
That 1,100 operations. 111 operations.
I was gonna say. Go ahead, Paul.
So taxing an addictive drug is usually considered a regressive tax. And in Massachusetts, let's look at how we've handled tobacco taxes. So we made $882 million last year in Massachusetts on tobacco tax alone. Only $3.8 million of it was used
toward smoking prevention and cessation programs. And what that actually means is that it went toward reimbursing hospitals, community health centers, for the cost of low-income patients that are uninsured or underinsured. The American Lung Association gave our state an F. This is in a tightly regulated market that is constantly being compared to how we should do this for marijuana. The American Lung Association gave Massachusetts an F on the report card for how they should increase funding to preventive and educational efforts. So my question is to my gentleman on the right, what, and I asked this to actually the Colorado drug czar when he visited UMass, I don't know, 5-6 months ago. I said, who's been tracking, when did you start tracking, and what are the social costs since you've legalized marijuana? And he looked all of the public health people in the room in the eye and he said, we're not interested in looking toward our past, we're interested in looking toward our future. So I also am interested in looking toward our future. I would also like to know the social costs of a law like this. So how much money are you going to give to prevention and education in a sort of lockbox committed capacity?
As much as we can.
Can we be specific?
Well, look, yeah, sure. Colorado collected
$135 million.
Now, their population is, I think, about 85% of ours. So let's.
What were the social costs?
Let's extrapolate that to say $150 million. Now, the cost of administration, you said, was about
$25 million.
$25 million. So there's $125 million. That, now, remember, Colorado has a higher tax rate than we're suggesting. And let me tell you why we're suggesting a lower tax rate, because this has been discussed, and this is very important. One of the things we, the committee, learned when we looked at the experience in Colorado was that the high tax rate kept the black market alive. And so that's why we set the tax rate lower, so as to discourage the black market operations and try to smoke them out.
No pun intended.
Social costs.
When I was speaking with the Colorado medical representatives today at the Department of Public Health over there, and they were talking about the tax, and they said that they set the tax high in the hopes that the price would be too much for kids to buy. And that was their
thinking
behind it.
Like with tobacco, that's, you know, they keep marking up the price for tobacco. And it's been a really preventative measure for decreasing youth use.
And by the way, can you really trust any money that's set aside for that purpose to be spent that way? Because tobacco tax money didn't get spent that way in Massachusetts. Go ahead, Buzz.
Oh, okay, sure. Hi, my name's Vanessa DeTruch. I'm a current GCC business student, also a former resident of Brockton, Massachusetts, where there is a huge opioid drug abuse problem. I'm also a graduate of Columbia University, majoring in biology. So I have a total of 3 questions. The first 2 are directed to Paul and David. And the last one is directed to the other 2 panelists. So the first one, specifically the study you referenced, David Sullivan, about the 48% increase in accidental deaths. That study, I think Kristen had asked whether how far it went back to 2006, and you said, if I'm correct, please correct me if I'm wrong at any point. But how can you prove causation at 2006, like, and not correlation? And you had kind of brought this up before too, Paul, causation versus correlation. Mm-hmm. So for that study in particular, how is it not, maybe there's just a gradual increase. Like, how can you prove causation in that particular case? And that was just a specific question. The next one's more general.
Sure, I can answer that. What happens when somebody is in a fatal car accident, and in some states they allow the extraction of blood from the living perpetrator, or they get it from the deceased. So the toxicology shows that there's THC in the system. And I can't prove definitively, neither can they, how much THC was in the system. But it was that dramatic rise in the THC levels of those that were in fatal and non-fatal accidents.
Doesn't THC also stay in the bloodstream for a while?
It stays in the bloodstream. Here's 2 things that happen. I've done a lot of work. I used to represent service members, and THC typically stays in the system 30 days, but the level, the milligrams of THC are at a higher level, very close to the accident. So it declines over the period. So that's basically where they got their information, was from toxicology, both from the morgue and from the hospitals.
What's the next question?
Oh, well, just to follow up with that one. So my question is, again, causation. So how do you know that event would not have happened regardless of whether or not the law had changed? That is my question. The increase you're attributing
to this law change, how can you provide evidence for that?
You can.
So you can.
Exactly.
No, you also no, you can, and you're wrong. Here's the way it goes. Every fatal accident has an accident reconstruction report. It determines who caused that accident. And that accident is usually caused by swerving into another lane, going off the road, rear-ending a vehicle going at a high speed. And that helps prove your causation of who caused that accident. And that's where they correlated the THC. So
did they break out how many of those?
The same they would, and the same they do for alcohol, okay? But we don't have a fail-safe system right now to determine the level of THC in somebody's system at that point of contact.
Paul, very quick.
You can also, you can't find causation with the opioid comparisons with marijuana use. You can make as many correlations as you want. The only real bona fide study I've seen about a decrease in opioid use disorder based on marijuana laws is states, this is the National Institute of Health said, states that have medical marijuana laws on the books have seen a decrease in opioid use disorder, which is super promising, right? That has nothing to do with recreational states, and it has nothing to do with commercialized for-profit marijuana. One thing I do want to mention about people, individuals with opioid use disorder, somewhere the north of 98% of individuals with opioid use disorder, their first substance that was psychotropic that they used was marijuana. 98% or more. So there's no causation there, but it's something to look at of like, When are you starting to wire your brain for what kind of behaviors?
I've got just kind of a general question. Y'all have used use disorder a couple times. What's the difference between use disorder and addiction?
It's the same thing. It's just a less stigmatized way of language.
Well, I have to respectfully disagree with my colleague here, because someone can have a substance use disorder and not be using. They can be in recovery, but they still have a substance use disorder. And if they happen to pick up a drink or a drug when they have substance use disorder, then they've relapsed. So it doesn't stop when you stop using the drugs.
It's a chronic brain disease. And that's something that we've acknowledged in the last 5 to 10 years of science.
But it's also important to remember, and Kevin Hill explained in his book, Marijuana, that the dependence on marijuana is much less severe than dependence on alcohol or dependence on opioids or dependence on prescription drugs.
We have a lot of people still want to ask questions. We're circling for a landing here, so let's go back to the audience.
Good evening. Thank you to all of you for being here tonight. I am a retired teacher, so I'm thinking, and I'm also a child of the 60s, you know, when
2%.
The whole marijuana stuff was
skunk
hot.
Weed.
And so my concern now is, like you all mentioned, is our future generations. 21-year-olds, I feel, are responsible and could be, well, they're young, but can make a reasonable decision as to whether they want to use a drug or not. However, my question is the way the law is worded. So my question is to both sides. One is, how is the law going to supervise the freedom to grow plants on your own? How is that going to be monitored? I mean, who's going to monitor that?
I'm gonna regulate that.
And then also that people, it says that 21-year-olds without payment and possess, produce, or transfer hemp to make or transfer to somebody else. You can give it to someone else that's 21-year-olds and older. How is that going to be monitored? That it isn't given to younger children. So my other question, my other question is, right now this is a law for 21-year-olds and older. However, our concern is for the younger people. Younger people are getting the drugs today illegally. How is the passing of this law going to benefit them? How are they going to get, let us say, like you say, that you're going to be having marijuana that is safer? But how is that going to happen? Because they're not supposed to get it anyhow. And yet we want to avoid them getting access to marijuana the same way that we do to alcohol and to tobacco. Because we do know that that does affect their development at the young age.
Let's have the proponents of the question start with that.
Sure. You're absolutely right. we're as interested as everybody else in making sure that people under the age of 21 don't have access to marijuana. That's why the initiative says no sales to people under the age of 21, no advertising that appeals to people under the age of 21. That doesn't necessarily mean that people under the age of 21 are not going to get the drug, but mothers in our focus groups have said to us, I think I said this before, I would rather my 18-year-old ask his older brother or sister to buy their marijuana in a regulated market that's safe than to have to buy it on the black market where they don't know what they're buying and they don't know what's in it. And so that's the answer to the first part of your question. We're never going to... And Dick referred to a way that we can educate young people about responsible choices with regard to marijuana. There was a study done in Colorado with 800 high school seniors, and they said that we don't want to hear the message about just say no anymore because we don't believe it. We want to hear a message about making responsible adult decisions about our use of marijuana. So that's the way that we have a prevention effort to make sure that folks under the age of 21 don't use marijuana.
How are you going to pay for it?
The money that will come from the taxation of marijuana, other than the 3.25%, which will go to regulation, will go to the general fund, and the legislature can make decisions about where that money is spent. They can make decisions about, they can decide that it will be spent on prevention or law enforcement or education or whatever the legislature decides to do with it. We can't mandate that money go anywhere in particular in a...
All right, Mr. Moderator?
In an initiative.
Mr. Moderator?
Yes.
There are some people who are really angry at us. They've had their hands up for a half an hour, so I'd like to give them a chance to just...
I'm perfectly fine with that. I want to get as many people to be able to make statements as possible.
Concisely.
Yeah.
Hi, I am a parent of two teenage boys. Next year, they're going to be going into a high school where the marijuana use rate is about 30% for 12th graders in the past 30 days. And I'm quite honestly very concerned about their health and well-being and their choices that they're going to be faced with making. And, you know, I know that this is marijuana regulated like alcohol, and I just don't think we're doing that great a job with alcohol. And, you know, you use the example of the parents, you know, being okay with their older teen giving it to their younger teen. Well, that's what happens with alcohol right now. And it's not really acceptable. It's not acceptable. We've let it be acceptable in our society that adults can buy for younger kids, and there's no real penalty facing that adult unless someone dies, you know, as a result. So, you know, I come from a long family of addicts and alcoholics. And, you know, my kids are susceptible. And the chances are that it's going to be really hard to keep them from trying drugs until they're 21. And I really fear the advertising that's going to come along with this and the accessibility of new products. Already my kids are like, but mom, we can vape without any nicotine. There's just flavors. And there are. You can just put flavors into your vape. And, you know, the new vape pens have... the ones that I'm told they're selling in Colorado have a place for the nicotine, a place for the, you know, marijuana oil, and a place for the wax. You know, they're all just all contained. You know, it's just these devices are really attractive. I know the same school that my kids are going to be going to next year has a 27% use rate of e-cigarettes that kids have ever tried using e-cigarettes. And, you know, that's just, you know, these new products, I don't know. So I guess my last comment and then question is, you know, I also, to the white-haired guy, of which
Dick.
There's many of us in the audience, and I would be if I, you know, but it's, you know, when you say prove prohibition works, it really resonates to me, like the tobacco industry that says prove cancer is caused by cigarettes. You know, it's, I'm, you know, it's like I'm a liberal, I'm really against big corporate industry, period, you know, and what it's doing to our communities.
And this is another one. So if you want to defend some of this, that's fine. But I really applaud all of you up here for coming out tonight.
Let's let Dick respond, then go to another person.
Yes, Attorney Evans. Respond to the last two questioners. Those were very good questions and very good concerns. You know, legalization is not going to put monitors outside on every corner and outside everybody's bedroom door any more than prohibition does. We're not going to use the legal system to ultimately protect people from themselves. What we will do, however, with prohibition, and this is going to be our biggest challenge after the passage of question four, our biggest challenge will be to develop a culture of responsible use around marijuana. And legalization will enable us to do that. And what that means is that we can acknowledge that marijuana is not for kids, but it may be okay for grown-ups. We can acknowledge that people shouldn't drive in an impaired condition. We can acknowledge that when someone decides to use marijuana, they ought to calculate, you know, the setting, they know what it is. People need to know how to avoid problems with marijuana. They need to avoid violating the rights of other people. It's the development of this culture of responsible use that ultimately is going to protect us all.
Okay, but let's go to the next comment. I want to get as many comments in as possible. We have about 5 minutes left. So if you have a comment, keep your hand up. Go ahead.
My name is Kate, and I am a medical marijuana patient. I just want to say, with the all of these figures and percentages and everything being thrown out, I just need to say that the different levels of the cannabinoids, the TAC, the total cannabinoid content, is higher, you know, depending on what substance you have. If it's a, you know, something you're smoking, vaping, all of those cannabinoids happen at different levels. And I just think that you're making it sound like it's a really scary thing when I have MS. My nerves actually start working when I ingest marijuana. I can't feel below my knees at all. I'm walking because, and I'm standing because I'm used to it, but smoking marijuana actually helps me feel everything. It helps my nerves conduct way better. I feel a lot better. It's done a lot for my mobility, my everything. That being said, I know that if you were to test me right now, I'm not stoned, I'm not high, I know that I have high levels of THC in my blood. So these are just points I'm making. That's not my question. I actually have a question that, because I thought we were going to be able to ask questions about this, the question. My question about the question is, am I going to have to pay this tax since I have a medical card? Because that's a important question, and I'd like to know that.
We'll answer that question, then we'll go to one more question.
The answer is no. Because the initiative says that the initiative will have nothing to do with the medical marijuana initiative that was passed in 2012. So there will be no tax, continue to be no tax on medical marijuana. But one of the things you raise is important to note. There are a lot of folks who don't want to get on the DPH list. They might be veterans. They might that are afraid of losing their VA benefits. They might be former federal employees who are afraid of losing their pensions. They might be they might have a firearms ID card. They might be undocumented immigrants. Many of those people don't want to be on the DPH list. But if they're willing to go to the adult use market and buy their medicine there, we believe that many more people who need medicine will be able to get it, because it will just be a decision between themselves and their doctor without involving the Department of Public Health. We voted in 2012 to institute medical marijuana. 4 years later, we have 7 dispensaries. In the first year, there were supposed to be 35. It's been glacially slow, and we believe that many more people will be able to get their medicine in the adult use market.
We got time for one more comment, and then we have to wrap things up.
Hi, my name is Linda Brink, and I'm a GCC returning student studying addiction counseling. And I am a strong advocate of this, and I felt very upset this evening when I really felt as if we were barraged by scare tactics. I question many of the statistics that were touted. I really question the cannabis being so strong that it could send someone into psychosis. I would really like to see some evidence on that, and I'd like to see whether psychosis was evident beforehand. But the bottom line is, we're not talking about legalizing pot for kids. We're talking about legalizing pot for adults, and that hasn't had a chance to be a venue this evening because of the scare tactics. Your kids are gonna have psychotic, you know. Truly, I really think that we've been gypped of a forum because of the fact that all you've talked about is, look out, the gummy bears are coming.
All right. So I appreciate what you had to say. I don't agree with it. I don't believe I came with scare tactics. I think that, well, you know, please don't interrupt me. I gave what I thought were from medical authorities, whether it's Mass Medical Association, whether it was NIDA. Let's face reality. What this referendum does not want to face is the scientific facts about teen and youth brain development. What it doesn't want to face is the fact that there are addiction and dependence issues that come with that. And the framework of smoking 90% THC, which happens with dab, I wasn't saying people would go psychotic. What I was saying is that there can be temporary psychosis. And I would encourage you to keep going forward with your addiction science. And what you will learn are there are three factors to addiction and dependence. Age of first use, which in Massachusetts is 12.8 years is the mean average for the use of marijuana for the first time. Age of use, genetics. What are in our genes? That's 50%, and the other is childhood trauma. Those are the three things that drive addiction. And will society be better? Will society have less addiction because of the passage of this ballot initiative? I say no. And I have the facts and the evidence to back it up, both from national and state authorities.
I'm going to let Dick Evans have the last word before we wrap up, just to be fair.
The initiative on November 8th will give voters the opportunity, as I said before, to get real about marijuana for the first time. It will bring us to the right side, finally, of common sense, of justice, and history. And that's why we need to do it.
I want to thank our panelists. Northwestern DA Dave Sullivan, Paul McNeil, Will Lucier from Campaign Manager for Yes on 4, and Attorney Dick Evans. I also want to thank our media people, Nikolai Anzoni, Steph Sliz, Kristen Palpini, Kate O'Neill, and Tom Relihan. I also want to thank Noah Loving, Kaylee DeMello, Jackson Gwynn, Megan Grace Slocum, Jasmine Gomez, and Jeff Parson, who are camera operators. And we also want to thank Laura Dentino for coordinating tonight's event, and to Buzz Eisenberg, and to GCC. My name is Chris Collins. Thanks for coming. And vote however you feel on November 8th. Thank you.